Good morning.
Morning.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Even in August, even though I know St. Mark, things slow down in August, in some respects it almost goes to sleep. And that's okay, because she will awaken in September, for sure. So I guess what that means is there isn't all that much for me to announce this morning, save the fact that I understand that everybody went to Jimmy John's last night, had a great, great time. Except the Bears, right? Was it 19-2 or something like that? What's that?
The Unicorns.
The Unicorns, okay. The Terror, 19-2, okay. What are you gonna do? But three quarters of the fun is just being together. Absolutely. So, all right, I know that Sandy has something she'd like to share with you.
Sure do. I just wanted to remind everybody that the campout is starting this week, and we still have openings, which, anyway, I mean, if you're on the fence about it, and you're wondering, like, if we still have space for you, we do. So just see me at the end of service, and everything, because I was looking at the signups, and we're a little light on signups for both the camping cart and also on Saturday, when we have the potluck, along with a brief church service, and social time and the fire pit. So I'm hoping that if you can't come up for the whole week or part of the week or whatever, that maybe you could just come up on Saturday and have a little fellowship with us and just let me know if you'll be able to make it and hope to see plenty of people there. Thank you.
Thank you, Sandy. We take this time now to prepare our hearts to worship God.
Thank you. one God who forgives all our sins, whose mercy endures forever.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Merciful God, we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed,
and are not worthy to be called your children.
Have mercy on us.
Turn us from our sinful ways. Bring us back to you, all those who once were dead, but now have life, through our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, full of anger, abounding in steadfast love. To all who believe in Jesus Christ, God grants freedom from the power of sin, and through the Holy Spirit gives life, forgiveness, and resurrection from the dead.
Amen. Thanks be to God.
These are our readings for the 10th Sunday after Pentecost. Our first reading is from the 55th chapter of Isaiah, beginning at verse 1. God invites Israel to a great feast at which both food and drink are free. God also promises to make an everlasting covenant with all peoples, with promises that previously had been limited to Israel. As David was a witness to the nations, these nations shall now acknowledge the ways in which God has glorified Israel. Now our reading. Ho, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters, and you who have no money, come, buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me and eat what is good, and delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me. Listen so that you may live. I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. See, I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and commander for the peoples. See, you shall call nations that you do not know, and nations that do not know you shall run to you because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. Here ends the first reading. We read responsibly. Psalm 145. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love.
Lord, you are good to all, and your compassion is over all your works.
The Lord upholds all those who fall and lifts up those who are bowed down.
The eyes of all rain upon you, O Lord, and you give them their food.
You open wide your hand and satisfy the desire of every living thing.
You are righteous in all your ways and loving in all your works.
You are near to all who call upon you, to all who call upon you faithfully.
You fulfill the desire of those who fear you. You hear their cry and save them.
You watch over all those who love you, but all wicked you shall destroy.
My mouth shall speak the praise of the Lord. Let all flesh bless God's holy name forever and ever.
Our second lesson is from the 9th chapter of Romans, beginning at verse 1. This begins a new section in Paul's letter in which he will deal with the place of Israel in God's saving plan. He opens by highlighting how Israel's heritage and legacy include being God's children, having God's covenants, being given God's law, participating in worship of God, and receiving divine promises. And now our reading. I am speaking the truth in Christ. I am not lying. My conscience confirms it by the Holy Spirit. I have great sorrow and unceasing anguish in my heart. For I could wish that I myself were accursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my own people, my kindred according to the flesh. They are Israelites, and to them belong the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the worship, and the promises. To them belong the patriarchs, and from them, according to the flesh, comes the Messiah, who is over all, God blessed forever. Amen. Here in the readings, please stand for the gospel.
Oh, that's me. There you go. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 14th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Okay, this morning I'm going to do something. I'm changing things a little bit here. And for the sake of context, I'm going to read a little bit more from Matthew 14. In fact, I'm going to back up a couple of verses. And I'm reading this morning from the Message. So don't try to follow along. I'm going to just get even more lost than I already am. Okay? Herod had arrested John, put him in chains, and sent him to prison to placate Herodias, his brother Philip's wife. John had provoked Herod by naming his relationship with Herodias adultery. Herod wanted to kill him, but he was afraid because so many people revered John as a prophet of God. But at his birthday celebration, he got his chance. Herodias' daughter provided the entertainment, dancing for the guests. Hubba hubba. She swept Herod away in his drunken enthusiasm. He promised her on oath, anything she wanted. Already coached by her mother, she was ready. Given me served up on a platter the head of John the Baptizer. That sobered the king up pretty fast. Unwilling to lose face with his guests, he did it. Ordered John's head cut off, presented to the girl on a platter. She in turn gave it to her mother. Later, John's disciples got the body, gave it a reverent burial, and reported to Jesus. When Jesus got the news, he slipped away by boat to an out-of-the-way place by himself. But unsuccessfully, someone saw him and the word got around. Soon a lot of people from the nearby villages walked around the lake to where he was. When he saw them coming, he was overcome with pity and healed their sick. Toward evening, the disciples approached him. We're out in the country and it's getting late. Dismiss the people so that they can go to the villages and get some supper. But Jesus said, there is no need to dismiss them. You give them supper. All we have, 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, they said. Jesus said, bring them here. Then he had the people sit down on the grass, and he took the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, lifted his face to heaven in prayer, blessed, broke, and gave the bread to the disciples. The disciples then gave the food to the congregation. They all ate their fill. They gathered 12 baskets of leftovers, about 5,000 were fed. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Even in this age of GPS and Google Maps and all of the devices that we have to navigate locally and around the state and even around the world, which I am well aware that there are young people in our midst who assume that this is the way that it has always been. Well, I can assure you that it is not the way it has always been. But even so, in spite of all the technology that we have, I can never help but laugh when someone fine-tunes their directions and they say to me, you can't miss it. And I think to myself, oh, yes, I can. I can miss it. I do it quite often, even with Google Maps. But it's not just out on the road, it's not just crossing Lake St. Clair that someone might say to us that kind of a thing. It has application to so many areas of our life. You can't miss it. This morning we go charging into Matthew 14, moving swiftly in the direction of the only miracle. And this is maybe for another time, but the interesting thing is that the word miracle never appears in the Bible. That word is never used. That's not to deny that some incredibly extraordinary things that divides our conventional understanding of the world happen, because they do happen, and they did happen, especially when Jesus was around. But the interesting thing, it is the only miracle that appears in all 4 Gospels. But in our haste this morning, and that's one of the reasons I backed up, was there's a tendency to miss something that I guess is easy to overlook. And it is Jesus' response to the news that his cousin had his life cut short by a petty, insecure tyrant fulfilling a drunken promise. Herod acts to save face because he is obsessed with what people think of him. He is insecure. And so Jesus goes off alone to a lonely place because the news that he receives from John's disciples, let's be honest, probably not totally, completely unexpected. All of us have received news that we expected at some point to hear, but it still hits hard. And it still hurts. And it doesn't necessarily make it any easier to receive that news. But nevertheless, as we have made mention of this many times before, being a prophet, a true prophet, not telling people what they want to hear, but being true to God's word, is a dangerous profession. It is as dangerous as being a coal miner. It's as dangerous as working the waves off the coast of Alaska. As we have said many times before, prophets have the highest insurance premiums of anyone we know. And so while this again isn't a surprise to Jesus, it still hits hard. It hurts. God, good to know, someone writes, that Jesus is no stranger to those kinds of feelings, especially when we find ourselves in a lonely place. We find ourselves in a place because of grief, because of the loss of our health, which often comes as an incredible surprise and a shock to us. When it comes to the loss of the health of someone that we love, when it comes to the loss of a relationship that we assumed would always be there, a job that you assumed would always be there, you name it, it can take you to that place. Now the question for me this week was, well, did Jesus find even some measure of comfort in that place? A good question, but all we can say for sure is that the quiet didn't last very long. Of course, when Jesus saw what was happening, he could have hightailed it back even deeper into the wilderness. He could have uncharacteristically thrown a temper tantrum. He could have said, you know, I'm just one person. I'm doing the best I can. Can I have a moment to myself? Is that asking too much? Have you ever felt that way, ever in your life? Is that asking too much? I ask that question sometimes, and then I answer my own question. Obviously, I was asking too much. But Jesus doesn't do that. Herod responded in fear. Selfish to the core, Jesus responds in faith, with compassion, because as one person has said, compassion ultimately is that almost fatal capacity to feel what it is like to live inside someone else's skin. It is good to see this morning that Jesus has obviously rubbed off a little bit on the disciples. Notice this morning in the Revised Oberlin Version, Matthew says, when it was evening, the disciples came to him and said, this is the middle of nowhere. Jesus, this makes the UP look like urban sprawl. And then they said to him, tell them to go into town, because there ain't nothing here. Because there isn't a McDonald's drive-thru, there isn't even a Chick-fil-A drive-thru. For thousands of miles, let alone 2,000 years. Admittedly, this morning, not exactly compassionate. But at least the disciples are beginning to think in terms of basic physical human needs. And that's good. Encouraging, somewhat at least. And so Jesus says to them, you give them something to eat. And they replied, Jesus, we have 5 barley loaves and 2 lousy trout. What in the world are you thinking? This is crazy. This is hopeless. But as each of us goes, Jesus is at his best in the dark. And he says to them, bring them to me. Now, I know what you heard this morning. I know what is printed in your bulletin. I know that Matthew says, as well as Luke and Mark and John, what actually happened. But the interesting thing is, and this isn't a new phenomenon, but the interesting thing is for many interpreters, well, maybe it's not fair to say many interpreters, but for some interpreters, especially with cell phones and quantum computing and AI and all the rest, this is a bridge too far. Just too far. Certainly, you don't take this literally. And I need to do something this morning to make this miracle more palatable to you. So I guess what we could say is that the disciples take the fish, and they brought their Ginsu knives, and they get to business. And they cut the fish and the bread down into postage size stamps so that at least everybody could get one. Or what really happened was that the crowd was so moved by the generosity and the sacrifice of the disciples that they had a secret stash of food and they decided that they would share it with others. Or actually, you could say that it happened just the way Matthew says it happened this morning. In the spirit of Isaiah 55, following the lead of Moses, of Elijah, and Elisha, meager rations become much in the hands of Jesus. As Barbara Brown Taylor says, in terms of these options, what you choose ultimately, not what I tell you to believe, but what you choose in trying to make sense of this incredible event, says a lot about your faith. In this case, the third option speaks to God's desire to meet our needs. From provision in the desert to 180 gallons of incredible wine, all the way to this table and to tables like it all over the world this morning, where we and millions of other people, millions, will be offered more than just a little piece of bread and a little bit of wine. The words of Matthew speak to a power on the side of life. They speak to an incredible power that isn't guided by selfish ambition, the need to impress, to make a name, but guided by compassion. And they also present an invitation that all that you have in this life is given to you as a trust. It is not yours forever. Your money, your stuff, hold it lightly. Raise it up. Bless it. Use it. And not just for yourself, and not just for your own little small circle of family and friends, but to meet the needs of others. Do this. Do it. And see what Jesus can do with even a little. Some people live their whole lives in a church, and all they ever get around to offering is something cut down to size of a postage stamp, and they miss out. How can Jesus can overpower the most hopeless situations with, as we have said, ourselves, our time, and our possessions? How the God of Good Friday can overcome the most heartbreaking and the most impossible situation and the most implacable dead end with life? Take all that you have, and you have it only for a while. I speak as an expert, having followed at least 600 hearses to the cemetery. At least 600. And never once have I seen a U-Haul. Never once have I seen them pour possessions into a six-foot hole. Not once in my life. And I have more experience than anyone you know. Take what you have. Hold it lightly. Hold it lightly. Place it in his hands. Just see what will happen. Amen. filled by the Spirit, let us join the whole people of God in Christ Jesus, praying for the church, those in need, all of God's creation. Incline your ear and come to us, gracious and our merciful God. Raise up among us here at St. Mark and in congregations around the world strong leaders who will guide the work of the church, so that everyone who grieves will know comfort. Everyone who is hungry will be fed. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, in this war-torn world, the thirst for justice and peace is never quenched. We pray for those who live under tyranny. Watch over them and be near to all who call upon your name. Lord, in your mercy. Strong Lord, when we are falling, hold us up. When we are bowed down with grief or loneliness, raise us up. When we are hungry, fill us. And when we are sick, heal us. We remember especially today Steve Wilson, Jeremy Loxner, Dave Garrett, Olivia Gant, Dawn Hall, Joel Kaufman, Marty Kaufman, and those that we now name for you out loud or in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy. Eternal Father, with gratitude for their loving witness and their lives, we remember those who are so dear to our hearts and who have died. Receive the prayers of all those who call upon your name. And grant us peace and hope, which the world can neither give nor take away. Lord, in your mercy. Now into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Share the peace.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace. Christ is with you.
Thanks be to God.